Hello physicists, welcome to Easy Physics. My name is Shubham and this is the lecture series of astrophysics. So today we are going to start its 7th lecture. And in the previous lecture, we have discussed the binary stars and its types. And we also discussed the visual binary star in detail. So in today's lecture, we will discuss the spectroscopy binaries and eclipsing binaries in detail. So let's start with spectroscopic binaries. So spectroscopic binary stars are those stars which are observed by using the spectroscopy. Let's see. Suppose here is a binary star system. And how do we know? We observe them from here. This is our location. And these stars are so close, or these stars are so distant, that we cannot see the individual star with our telescope. So how do we know that there are two separate stars? We use the spectroscopy. Now let's see how we use the spectroscopy. Let's say here is the center of mass, and this star revolves like this. Let's say this is the another star, and here is the center of mass, and this star revolves like this, and the another star, let's say it's B, another star B revolves like this. Okay, now this star will have the velocity as VA, this direction, similarly star B has a velocity this, this, this. Okay, now we don't know what is the velocity, we just observe that from here. Now when the star is at this position, now star is coming towards us, we can see from here star is coming towards us, and is this location the star is going away from us. Okay, now we recall the Doppler shift. Doppler shift. So what is this? It describes that if a source, we will consider this case according to our condition of stars. So according to Doppler shift, if a light source or the observer is moving, light source or the observer are moving, or we can say there is a relative velocity between the light source and the observer, then we will not receive the light same as the wavelength it has. We will receive light with some different wavelength. The wavelength have some shift. And how it works? Let's say it has a wavelength lambda, and the light source is coming towards us, or we can say there is some relative velocity such that the light source is reaching to us. Then if the actual wavelength of the light is lambda, then the wavelength of the light that we will receive will be, let's say, lambda dash, and in this case lambda dash will be smaller to lambda, and we will have a shift. And we say the blue color light has a smaller wavelength in the visible region. So we say this case as a blue shift, because the wavelength is shifting towards shorter wavelength and blue color has a shorter wavelength. And similarly, if the light source is moving away, then we will observe some wavelength, let's say lambda double dash, and in this case lambda double dash will be greater than the lambda which was the original wavelength. So we say here is a red shift. Because the wavelength of red color light is greater, larger. So we can use the Doppler shift in our case. Let's say how. Here, this star is reaching to us. Then we will see a blue shift. Okay, now let's see a case here. In this case, the star is neither reaching to us nor going away from us. So in this case, we will not have any shift. So we will receive the original wavelength. There is some difference because the space itself is expanding, so there are factors. But if we ignore that thing, then we will receive the actual wavelength of the light. Again, if we come to this point, then the star is going away from us. So in this case, we will have the red shift. Similarly, the star B will show the blue shift and red shift. And at the time when star A is showing blue shift, the star B will show the red shift. Okay, and the vice versa. So we have the relation between the relative velocity of the source and the observer and the shift in wavelength and the original wavelength, which is lambda naught. Here delta lambda is the change in wavelength and lambda naught is the original wavelength, and lambda naught is the wavelength when the star is at this location or this location or this location or this location, and delta lambda is the shift in the wavelength, let's say at this location. Okay, so using this relation we can find the velocity of the star at some location. And if we consider the case of circular, then the star will have the same velocity during its whole circular path. So we can say that we can find the velocity of star A and star B using the Doppler shift. Okay. Now we have the velocity VA and the velocity of star B, VB. Okay. This is the case when our line of sight makes the angle 0 degree or approximately 0 degree with the plane of the orbit. But it is not necessary that we will have this case. We can have some case in which let's say this is the plane of orbit and we are viewing this from here, and let's say it is making some angle theta, or you consider according to your convince. So the things will change here, okay? Because we would not calculate the actual velocity of the star ray, and actually we will find some component of its velocity. Actually, this is the velocity. We will find some component of its velocity. So this is the another case. We will discuss it later. First, for simplicity, we will find the things according to this case. Okay. Now, we have the velocity of star A and velocity of star B, and the velocity during the whole path will be same, because we considering it as the circular path. So let's see what we can find using this information. We know that let's say it is the distance from the center mass is RA, and the distance of center of mass of star B is RB, and the separation between star A and star B is, let's say, R. Now we know RA plus RB is equal to R. And if I multiply with 2 pi upon t, the whole expression RA plus RB is equal to 2 pi R upon t, and 2 pi RA upon t plus 2 pi RB upon t is equal to 2 pi R upon t. Now, what is 2 pi RA upon t? 2 pi RA is the total path in one revolution of star A, and t is the time period. So it will give us the velocity of star A. VA plus VB is equal to 2 pi R upon t, or we can write this equation in terms of R. It is t upon 2 pi VA plus VB. Let's say equation number 1. We can have some other relation, as we have calculated in the previous lecture. Using the center of mass, we can say RA MA is equal to RB MB. MB is the mass of star B, and MA is simply mass of star A. Now, if I multiply this equation with 2 pi up by t, and similarly 2 pi by t, then what I will have? This is 2 pi RA upon t, again this is V, and this is 2 pi RB upon t, and this is VB. So I can have, similarly using these two, I can have VA MA is equal to VB MB. Okay, I can write this relation as MA upon MB is equal to VB upon VA. Let's say equation number 2. So what we have in equation 1, we have the time period which we can easily know by just viewing the periodicity of the spectrum of star A and star B, and VA is the velocity of star A and VB is the velocity of star B, all the variable we know, so we can easily calculate R. And here we know VB and VA, so we can know the relation of the ratio of MA and MB. So now we know the separation R and the ratio of mass A and mass B. Here we can use the relation of Kepler's law, which we have calculated, which was something like T square is equal to 4 pi square by Gm and Rq. So I can use this relation here. So I have T square is equal to 4 pi square Gm and T by 2 pi VA plus VB Q. So this is T square is equal to 4 pi square by Gm and I can write TQ upon 2 pi Q VA plus VB Q. Now I can simplify this. Here is Gm by T. I can cancel T square with T cube. The T will remain here. Here is 2 pi square and 2 pi cube. So I can write 1 upon 2 pi and VA plus VB Q. So I can also write this equation in the form of mass. So mass is equal to T VA plus VB Q upon 2 pi G. So I know the time period, I know the velocity of star A, I know the velocity of star B. So I know the total mass of the binary star system. Okay, so here I actually know MA plus MB, which is equal to the T VA plus VB cube upon 2 pi G. Here I can take some term common, which could be MA plus MB is equal to T. I can take common VA. So VA cube, here is 1 plus VB upon VA cube upon 2 pi G. So I can write MA plus MB is equal to T VA
T VA cube 1 plus
and VB upon VA is equal to MA upon MB. So I can use
upon
2 pi G. So I can write MA plus MB is equal to T VA cube MB plus MA upon 2 pi G and MB. Here is a Q. So here is a Q. Is it all right? We a Q. Yeah. So I can write MB cube upon the remaining term is MA plus MB square, because one term will be cancelled from here, is equal to T VA cube upon 2 pi G. Yeah. So here is mass of B cube upon total mass is equal to T VA cube upon 2 pi G. So I can calculate the mass of star B from here, and after calculating the mass of star B, I can just simply put the value of mass of star B in this equation, which is the mass of star A is equal to mass of star B multiplied by velocity of star B upon velocity of star A. So here we have all the relations. We can find the total separation, and we can find the total mass. Here is the relation, and we can find the mass of individual star. So we can use the relation according to our need, and we have calculated almost all the necessary relations. So we can see in this relation that mass of A is equal to mass of B into velocity of B upon velocity of A. So the mass of star A and B just depend upon the ratio of the velocities. So here we can see if the velocities of two stars are equal, then the mass of both stars will be equal. Now let's see what is eclipsing binaries. Before discussing this, let's see the another case that I told that I will discuss later. So suppose the plane of the orbit is not making the angle 0 degree to our sight of line. Let's say here is the plane of both stars. Let's say star 1, star A, and here is star B. Let's say here is the center of mass, and we are looking this system from here. Now we are looking this way, and this is the plane. This is the plane of the system, and if I draw a line perpendicular to this plane, then the angle between our line of sight and the perpendicular of the plane is known as angle of inclination. In the some books it is mentioned as the angle between our line of sight, the angle between the plane of orbit and the plane of sky. I is the angle between the plane of orbit and the plane of sky. So what is the plane of sky? The plane of sky is always the plane in which direction we are looking. Let's say we are looking here. So in this direction, at every place the plane of sky is defined as this plane. Let's say this is the z axis. So the plane of xy axis is known as the plane of sky. And if we are looking here, then the plane of sky will be like this. So the plane of sky in this case will be defined as this plane. So the angle between the plane of sky and the perpendicular, the plane of sky and the plane of orbit is known as angle of inclination. Okay, so you can define this in either way, as the angle between the line of sight and the perpendicular axis of the plane of orbit, or the angle between the plane of orbit and the plane of sky. So we will think according to this angle. So let's say in this case a star actually coming in this direction, but we are observing it as it is coming in this direction. So we are actually taking the component of star in the direction of line of sight. So if we see this, then this will be the angle I. Okay, this will be the angle I, because this is also, this is a parallel line of the line of sight. Actually this is the line of sight. So this angle will be I. So the component of the velocity in this direction will be, if this is VA, then component in this direction will be VA sine I. Okay, this angle will be pi by 2 minus I. So the component of VA, the velocity of star A is in this direction, and its component in our line of sight will be VA sine theta. Okay, so we are actually observing VA sine theta. We are observing VA sine theta, and the actual velocity of the star is VA. So when we will calculate our result according to our observed velocity, it will give us the wrong results, because the actual velocity is v and we are observing only the component of this velocity. So we will have the relation between our observed velocity, let's say v dash a is equal to va sin I. So va is equal to va dash upon sin I. Okay. Now, in every relation that we are using with the velocities, we will use this value in the place of VA and VB. Similarly, as I have calculated VA, similarly, VB will be defined as VB dash upon sin I, where VB dash is the observed velocity of star B. Such that here it is, we are observing this way or this way, VB. So let's say in this relation, let's say mass is equal to time period. VB, we use VA dash upon sin I plus VB dash upon sin I cube upon 2 pi G. So we can write M is equal to T VA dash plus VB dash upon 2 pi G sin I. Why we are doing this? Sin cube I. Why we are doing this? Because we know the value of VA dash. We don't know the value of VA. So we need to put the value of VA dash in this relation. So we will get the correct value of mass. Now here is another question, how we will measure the angle of inclination I. So there are several methods of this and we are not going to discuss this thing here. So we will just calculate the mass and the other variables. We can also calculate RA and RB. So we can write VA is equal to 2 pi RA upon T. So RA will be VA T upon 2 pi, and in place of VA we will write VA dash upon sin I. So RA will be VA dash T upon 2 pi sin I. Similarly, we will find RB is equal to VB dash T upon 2 pi sin I. Now we have the total mass RA, RB, and we can also write the mass MB cube upon, okay, here is M square, M square
is equal to T V A dash cube upon 2 pi G sine Q Y, and the relation of mass A. Similarly, we write T V B dash upon 2 pi G sine Q I.
Now, just take a look on the graph of the velocity of star A and velocity of star B with time. So, for this, let's consider again, here is a star A, which is the lighter star. Here is center of mass. And let's say here is a star B, which is the heavy star, so that it is near the center of mass. We know the heavy object is always near the center of mass. So let's say this is the orbit. And the velocity of this star will be high and the velocity of this star will be low, because the both star will have same time period, same angular velocity. So star A will reach this location after time t, and in the same time star B will reach in its initial position. So to cover the same distance, larger distance in the same time, it must have larger velocity. So the lighter star, which is further away from the center of mass, will have the higher velocity. We can also see this case using the relation that we have derived. Mass of star A upon mass of star B is equal to velocity of star B upon velocity of star A. So let's see, in this case, if mass of star A is smaller than mass of star B, we will find velocity B is smaller than velocity of A. So velocity of A must be larger. So if I draw the velocity time graph, let's say time is a velocity, and the thing which we need to notice, that this is the radial velocity. Radial velocity, I mean the velocity in the direction of our side. If you are observing the star from here, then this velocity means the velocity at which the star is approaching you. So let's say here is a velocity VA dash, which is appearing you that it is approaching you, that after some time the star will go like this, and after some time the star will go like this, and at this location the star is going in this direction. So according to you, star is not coming to you. Okay, just before star was here, and just after star was here. So in this path star had some time, but star did not come to you. So for this, you find the velocity of star A as zero here at this location. So the radial velocity of star will be a variable. Let's say here is a velocity, some velocity which is very high because the star is directly coming to you. So let's say here is a velocity VA, and as it is going here, the velocity is decreasing. Okay, and it will come to zero at this location. So we can say the velocity will work like this. Okay, and after this, the star will go like this. So star is going away from you. So when star was approaching you, I was taking the velocity as positive. This was only my convention. Okay, you can take the case according to you. So I was taking this sign as positive when the star was coming to you. Now star is going away from you, so you will take the velocity as negative. So the velocity gets increases in negative direction. In negative direction, and velocity will approach maximum here. You will find the same velocity, but this velocity is in opposite direction. So if this is V A dash, and this the maximum negative velocity will be V A dash minus, and again after this it will start at decreases and approaches to zero, like this location. Okay, this will go like this in this direction, so it will again comes to zero, and similarly it will follow the graph again. Now let's focus on the star B. When the star A is coming to us, let's say positive velocity, the star B was going away from us. Okay, it will move like this system. So this star will coming down, so this star was going up. Okay, so this star was going away from you, so we will take the velocity as negative. So at this time we are taking this time, so it had some negative velocity, but the less value than A. So let's say VB dash minus, and it will, if we follow the back path, so it was zero at this location, and after some time when the star A had the zero velocity, it also came to this location, and it also had the zero velocity, so it will go like this. So here is the velocity time graph of star A and star B. The thing we see that here is a complete period, so this is known as the total time period of revolution, and we can see that the total time period is same for both stars. We can also write this as VA upon sine VA is equal to VA sine I. If this plane is not like this, this plane making some angle with the our line of sight. So we have discussed the spectroscopy binaries, and we will continue this topic in the next lecture, and we will discuss eclipsing binaries. So if you have some doubt, then comment in the comment section so that I could clear that doubts in the next lecture. And if you like this video, then press the like button and subscribe the channel and share this video as much as you can to support the channel. Thanks for watching Easy Physics.